Hey, this is Charles on Yet with IGN. I'm here with Anthony Gallegos.
Hello.
And we are trying something a little different for PC coverage, where we're putting together what we want to do is a weekly episode called Command Prompt, where we highlight three PC games. They could be already released, they could be super old, they could be in development, just whatever we happen to think is interesting that week, and put them into this package called Command Prompt. That's the name of a podcast that used to run years ago at IGN, which probably five people remember. But we want to kind of revive that as a actual video series. So you can just count on this showing up, hopefully, assuming everything functions properly, on a weekly basis, so you can see what's going on in PC land, in the weird world of PC gaming.
And there's always weird things in PC games, every week. I mean, so much that we can't even always write about all of them, so it's kind of nice to be able to highlight certain ones in video form especially.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely one of the unique things about the PC market, is it is so gigantic, and you know, if somebody is normally used to playing console games and things like that, There really aren't that many surprises in the console world. Everyone knows about the big games coming out. XBLA games don't come out at a rate that you can't really keep track of them. You will find surprises for like Xbox indie games and things like that. You'll find the random, I guess, diamond in the rough or whatever you want to call it on that service. But yeah, in general, you know what's going on. Whereas in the PC world, yes, you have Steam, you have other digital distribution platforms, But it's pretty much just like a lawless Wild West once you move off of those areas. And there's, you know, huge mods communities around a whole bunch of different games. There are people releasing games through, you know, anything, really. There are a whole bunch of ways to get into different types of play experiences. And in general, the play experiences tend to be much more experimental.
Yes. Such
as what we're watching right here, which is DayZ. This is a mod for Arma 2.
Yeah, I mean, they took one of the most hardcore military sims out there, if not the most hardcore military sim, and turned it into an even, in some ways, more hardcore zombie sim, or zombie apocalypse simulator. So you're like on a Russian island with all these zombies that are out trying to kill you, but in the way, like, you know, you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, actually my guy's getting to a pretty desperate point as far as water goes.
And, yeah, you got a zombie attacking you right now. Are you bleeding?
Yeah, so when you bleed, you get like this nice little fountain of jelly that comes out of you.
That's realistic, right?
Yeah, totally. I mean, so it is kind of a little silly in many ways, but I mean, it's hardcore in the sense that, you know, when you do something like that, like, you will bleed out to death if you do not bandage yourself. And as you get to certain levels of bleed out, your vision will gray, you might randomly fall and pass out when you exert yourself. So you really actually have to really pay attention to the various needs of your guy and everything. Like as far as, like, if you're hurt, if you break a leg, you can't walk at all unless you find morphine to get over the pain. And even then, you're going to need someone to help you fix your broken leg. So eventually, if you lose enough blood, you'll need a transfusion. But to do that, you'll have to get another player on board, which that's where the real appeal of this kind of comes in, is, like, it's scary enough as it is trying to survive in a world where zombies are. But what makes it even crazier is that you have to do it in a world where other survivors aren't necessarily your friend.
And it is multiplayer, so those are other players running around.
But for some reason, I don't know what happened. I joined this game, and I don't know if it's something enabled on the server, but I'm pretty sure these white dots you can see, I'm pretty sure that those are zombies. Like, it's just showing me where zombies are.
Yeah, so you hop into different servers in the game, some of which have different rule sets. Yeah, it looks like you're...
Yeah, like I have zombie vision.
It's like cheat mode.
Yeah.
Unless that was a really sweet bandage you just applied.
It just gave me true sight.
Your character progress is kept constant regardless of which server you jump into. Although if you do die, that's it, right?
Yeah, when you die, it's permadeath. You lose all the stuff that you managed to scrounge around and find.
But it's not like you have to keep joining the same server to access the same character.
No, yeah, you could jump around to any server and just keep playing with the same character. It's all stored on their side. So they know, like, if that survivor has been alive for 21 days and has a badass assault rifle, if you join another server, he will still have that badass assault rifle. Which, to be fair, I've never once found a gun in this game.
Yeah, so I guess finding weapons is not really the easiest thing. You kind of have to scrounge around, and I guess you used to start with a weapon, but then recently that was kind of taken out.
So yeah,
you just start with nothing.
I think the guy decided it wasn't hardcore enough, so now you you pretty much start with a bandage and a flashlight and a prayer. So, and everyone just starts out on the beach, and the first thing my friend told me is, like, as soon as you start, run away from the beach, because people with guns will try and pick off new players to get their bandages and
stuff. That's pretty brutal. I mean, have you seen that happening? Have you seen people just trying to destroy other players in order to take their supplies and things like that?
So there's 24 other people on this server, and I've only ever seen, it's a huge area. It's like 223 square kilometers. And I've only ever seen one player one time, and he did everything in his power just to get away from me. He just had no desire to be around me whatsoever.
Well, because, yeah, in a lot of ways, the other players are more threatening than the actual zombies that are walking around.
Right, I mean, and that's the cool thing about this game is, like, the stories that come out of it. Like, talking about this game is way more exciting than playing. Like, right now, you know, a lot of times this game is like a jogging simulator, but then there's also the times where I get to tell you an epic story about when I finally acquired a weapon, managed to kill a zombie, and get something like, this is the most empowered I've ever been in this game, and all I have is a dumb axe. But
it's like a pretty good axe, actually.
Well, yeah.
It seems to take out zombies pretty quickly. They're not like super powerful or anything.
The bad
like that.
Thing, though, is that every time I take out a zombie, I can't do it without being hit. So it's only a matter of time before, like, if I do it at the wrong time, I can get infected. And right now, actually, this survivor, as good as I'm doing, he's going to totally die from thirst.
Yeah, that's the flashing jug on the bottom of the screen there.
Yeah.
So where are water sources? Could you go to the beach and drink I guess that would be ocean, so that really wouldn't be a very good idea.
Yeah, I know, and I found fresh water once in a lake and I couldn't drink it. You have to find, like, canteens. So,
oh God.
That's kind of why I'm roaming around towns hoping to...
Zombies are so fast.
Yeah, that's the thing is, this guy has a Pepsi on him.
Is that gonna cure thirst?
We're gonna find out.
Temporarily, and then make you thirstier?
Oh my God, yeah.
Nice.
So, now I just have to worry about food and whatnot.
So you will actually get drops off of zombies. They're not just, it's not just a kill or something.
Right, I mean, you know.
So there's some incentive to killing them and not just staying away from them.
And that's the thing, is that the only places that zombies spawn in this is around towns. But you have to go to town to find supplies. You know, so you inevitably have to encounter zombies and other players. So sometimes players might band together to take a town and finish it, but it's not uncommon that as soon as the zombies are all finished off in the town, everyone turns on each other and just starts killing each other. Oh, God.
So, yeah, I mean, what you're doing now, is this typical of gameplay where you're actually fighting quite a few zombies, or would you normally just want to steer clear, like, hide in the grasses, basically, try to make sure that no zombies do see you?
Yeah,
Oh, wow, there's quite a bit in here.
I'm being a lot more aggressive than I ever would normally. Normally, if I was doing this, I would never even get off my belly the whole time I'm in town. So the zombies have really good hearing, but their eyesight is pretty terrible. So you can actually, if you crawl, you can usually get through towns relatively easily.
But that takes a while, so you're just sitting there spending, you know, like 30, 40 minutes.
Yeah, like this is the crawl speed. But it is not uncommon that I will do this through a whole town. Because you see in the upper middle top area, you can see an ear and eye. And that shows you how visible and how much sound you're making. But like,
oh, there's a hopping zombie.
Yeah,
there.
But I can...
Those are terrifying, by the way.
It is, yeah. But I can totally get ridiculously close to this guy and he won't even see me. Oh, I'm an idiot. Well, you can still get a lot closer than you could if you're standing. Like, when you're... God.
Wow, you have sprung a leak. That looks like it would be really painful. Your guy's actually reacting quite normally, considering there is
a giant gout
of blood.
He's
just losing, like, a liter a second.
Yeah.
And then bandages... I mean, what happens if you don't have a bandage? You're basically screwed at that
point. Yeah, you will bleed to death. You know, and eventually, even if you do have a bandage, like... A bandage does not recover health, it only prevents you from losing more. So
So you would need to find some kind of food item or something like
that. I don't even think food recovers health though. All food does is restores your food meter. So I'm not really sure exactly. As far as health, I think you might actually have to do a blood transfusion with another player.
Oh, okay.
And that's if you can get them to agree to do a blood transfusion with you. So this is definitely the sort of game that a lot of really cool stories come out, but also kind of worth playing with other people. Oh God.
Yeah, if you like had a group of friends and everyone would just jump on the server and you might want to try to survive as a pack so that you could get that extra assistance. Although yeah. There's something pretty, I mean, in survival horror experiences like this, and this definitely is survival horror.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really, you, what were you saying? There's something to be said about being alone.
Yeah, I mean, the solitary experience is pretty cool because, you know, you really are just reliant on yourself and on your skills. And it's not, because it's not a forgiving game, everything you do, the significance of every single action you take, every single place you decide to explore, even like every time you decide to move from a crawling state to a crouching state, there's that much more significance on those actions. So even though you may just be crawling across the field, it doesn't feel boring just because you're thinking about all of the horrible things that could go wrong. And the fact that if you do screw something up, that's it. You're screwed. That's like endgame, basically.
Yes, I've been playing by myself, but I kind of find it, it is very scary. Like, it's hard to hear when we're talking, but the game has like really ominous music and really intense like sound effects, and even though like the animations on the zombies and stuff are kind of dumb at times, like they're still like alarming when they sneak up on you, and they are relentless when they see you. They will chase you till the ends of the earth. So you either have to manage to outwit them or just jump into the grass. But everything in this game just has such weight. Like, I think that's the benefit it gets from coming from that ARMA thing. The ARMA games.
And I mean, so if you go into the forest here, that's probably not a good idea, right? Because assuming you didn't have these giant circles highlighting the zombies for you, you normally wouldn't be able to see them just because of the extra tree.
Yeah, this isn't even a zombie. This is a pig. Well, that pig's going down.
That pig did not try very hard to defend itself.
I have a knife, so I'm going to gut it for meat.
So if you didn't have a knife, would you not be able to interact with that?
Yeah. That is.
Oh, you just got 4 meat steaks.
Yeah.
You have to cook those, though, I guess.
Yeah, so I have meat now, but I have to find... I have to manage to find of matches. So I can't even cook. I can't even eat it right now. So if I can find matches, though...
And those would be somewhere in town, so that's just another incentive to go into a threat area.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if somebody wanted to install this, because this is free, right? So you can just go to the DayZ site.
Yeah, it's DayZmod.com if you guys want to check it out. But yeah, but to do so, you actually need ARMA 2 Combined Operations, which isn't expensive. It's like $30 at this point. But
also, ARMA 2 is a pretty good game. I actually like ARMA quite a bit. And ARMA 3, which is supposed to come out next year in 2013, also looks really good. They were showing that off actually at E3 2012 recently, and the visuals, I mean, this game still looks good.
Yeah, I mean, they do a really good job of just capturing kind of how creepy these, like, these woods are just kind of, it's a creepy place.
Yeah, I like their lighting. It's very washed out. Everything's very stark and colorless, and I think that adds to kind of the sense of desolation that's really in this world. That, you know, this is a dead world.
Yeah,
basically,
it is a bad place. It is a sad Russian dead place. Like, it really does feel like that. You know, it almost feels like a Chernobyl or something like that in a lot of ways. But with zombies and horrifying, horrible things.
But yeah, and this just, I mean, if you're not really that familiar with PC gaming, this just gives you a sense of what's really possible with it, just because you wouldn't get this type of experience on consoles, where somebody just gets a really good idea and decides to build a total conversion for a game. You know, it's been part of the PC scene for quite some time, and it is still, to this day, one of the advantages to the PC platform, and something that no console manufacturer has really ever implemented successfully.
Yeah, I mean, I just really like this, just because at this point it's given whole new legs to ARMA 2 as well. Like, if you go on to multiplayer, you can find regular ARMA 2 multiplayer games, but the vast majority of people at this point are throwing down DayZ matches. Oh god.
You can't throw that axe, can you?
No.
I like how the axe just emits smoke regardless of where, of what you're hitting. Oh, what do you have?
An empty water bottle.
Okay.
I don't know if I can use that. You apparently can also find bikes, engine parts, fixed cars. So I don't really know. I haven't done much with any of that yet. But.
So you could ride a bicycle around to try and move a little bit faster?
Yeah, there are hilarious videos of people riding bicycles around other survivors while shooting them. So there's a lot to this game that I have yet to discover in my brief adventures. This is my longest living survivor. It should be pretty telling when I tell you that. And he's only lived about 2 hours. So
so it is pretty, it's not something you're just going to jump in and immediately defeat everything. There's a definite learning curve.
Yeah,
there.
Like Minecraft, people really have to, you know, you gotta plan on playing this game with a wiki. But it just really is a great example of just why the PC platform is kind of a really special place for people that are willing to put in the time and effort to get mods to work.
Yeah, and still, and I think especially now that the console cycle is kind of, there's less and less excitement about getting, you know, Xboxes and PS3s at this point, just because it's so late in the console cycle that, you know, more attention is given to the PC platform because it's moving forward, and basically everything that consoles need to do at this point is already happening on PC between distribution models and just giving games more longevity through things like mods like this, where people are all of a sudden talking about Arma 2 all over the place, whereas, you know, a while ago nobody was talking about that game.
Yeah, I'm really pleased that I ended up picking up this game. It's really silly, but I'm loving it.
So next we're gonna check out Guild Wars 2. We were in a recent test session, and I will say, when we recorded the clip, when we recorded the whole segment, ArenaNet had not yet actually announced the release date for Guild Wars 2, and then we walked in the next morning and there it was. There was the release date to Guild Wars 2. So you're gonna hear talk in the next segment about, oh, I wonder when they're gonna talk about a release date. It should happen soon. And well, it happened. It's August 28th. That's when that game's coming out. So end of summer. So just keep that in mind while you're listening to us speculate about why they haven't actually announced anything yet. So we're playing Guild Wars 2 right now. I am in an arena battle, and it was going pretty well, but it's not right now. So there are a couple different ways to play Guild Wars 2 PvP, and probably the worst way is to have about five people trying to kill you at the same time. So I'm trying to run away right now.
The good thing is that even though Charles, you know, he only started this just this afternoon, but they boost everyone up to level 80. So, you know, he didn't have to sit here and level a character. They kind of put everyone on equal footing. So Charles can try out high-level abilities and gameplay.
Oh, I did separate someone from the pack there. Oh, God, I'm dead. I'm so dead.
It's also really cool because the abilities in Guild Wars are all linked around the weapons that you have. Yeah, so right now Charles is down fighting for his life. If he managed to kill someone...
Oh, my God, they might die.
Oh, my gosh. Oh.
I don't think I killed him.
If you manage to kill someone, you get to stand back up in, like, a second wind sort of thing.
You do get this cool death breakdown, though, so they show you sort of like... I mean, you can see this in the Dota 2 beta as well, but when you get killed, they show you where the incoming damage sources were.
That's good. I mean, that way, I guess, you can try and think maybe I need to try and plan out to counter, like, ranged attacks or that sort of thing.
Yeah, I think that was the incoming damage because it didn't match up with my skills.
I like that they level you up to level 80. I just wish they didn't give you... I'm going to admit, your armor's pretty dumpy looking.
You don't like my...
By the time you're level 80 in Guild Wars, I hope that you have a cooler looking armor set than that.
My pink scale armor?
No, you... I mean, come on. For high-level armor, we all want shoulder pads that are, like, 7 feet coming off of our body.
So you want the WoW shoulder pads?
I'm saying I want something that makes me feel like a level 80. That guy looks like he just is, like, you look like some king's every guard. You're just another...
Well, this is the default 80 gear they put you in when you auto-level your character from... Like, you could be basically level 1, and you could do the Be in the Mist option, which is right... Actually, I can show that. It's right in the menu here. You say, go to the Mist, and then you're there with a level 80 version of your profession so that you can get a sense of how the profession levels, and it unlocks almost everything. Oh my God, make it...
That's true, and I guess it is kind of nice because they have this set of armor, and it actually does help you differentiate who's just, like, being boosted.
Oh my God, I'm totally going to ground stomp. What?
Charles is playing a warrior. Which, you know, you may not guess because he's using a gun, but, you know, since all the skills in this game are based around the weapon, Charles can kind of equip whatever he wants and just get a bunch of new abilities for his warrior. And warriors are pretty diverse with the weapons they can use.
They are, and also, is Sickerl actually taking any damage here? Oh, yeah, there she goes. I'm going to try to stomp again, see if that...
I think this is a warrior versus warrior battle here.
Uh-oh, I have chains. Ugh. Oh, God. Doing so much damage. Every class also gets a heal, so that's what I'm using there. And I think we totally lost.
Yeah.
Sick Girl's pretty good. She had 125 points. I only had 55, and that was second to somebody who had zero.
I will note, though, you were barely in the game. You weren't in it that long, so that's not necessarily fair.
That's true, and it will load up another map. I think there are two map types that are available in the PvP arenas right now. There are... they're basically capture point maps, essentially.
I'm still waiting to find out, like, when are we going to get to play this game?
Oh, I haven't actually played this map yet.
I mean, we still don't
know. I hope it's as cool as this concept art.
I doubt it.
No, I also doubt it.
I mean, don't get me wrong, Guild Wars, it may not be as cool as the concept art, but it's still a really great looking game. Like, I love the way that they handle lighting in it, and even just the setting is just, it's really pretty.
Yeah, no scene ever looks very conventional, although there are certainly some areas that are more impressive than others. I think that just kind of happens. But yeah, even you can see on this terrain, like, this wall isn't going across, like, in a directly straight line. It's all angled. It's all artfully presented, so it doesn't
look... Oh, my God.
Whoops. Oh, my God.
One thing I feel like the Char kind of suffer, though, from... the Char, the race he's playing right now, that kind of suffer from is, like, when you used to play Tauren in World of Warcraft, was that even though they're moving at the same speed as everyone else running, I feel like they look so much slower. Oh
yeah,
my God.
I'm not a big fan of the Char's running animation. I don't think I'm going to play as them when the game launches. There's the Silvari, which are basically the elven race. Oh my God, I think we're actually going to get a kill here.
I can't, man, and it's going to be of Sickgirl too. She's determined to get you though, but I think that's going to be her downfall.
All right, I just went Super Saiyan. Now I can throw rocks and kick. And whatever that was.
I think that was your kick.
There's my rock. Did I hit her?
Out of range.
She's pretty fast. She's almost getting out of there. I don't know if she's gonna die. She's almost dead.
Yeah. She went down.
Now I'm gonna die. I better heal myself.
Man, they really don't mess around though. They get you right into the fray, like within like 2 seconds.
Yeah, so the skill system is pretty complex. I mean, it does change depending on which weapon you're holding. So if I switch over to my axes, I have 2 one-handed axes, and now I get an entirely new skill set with these. And some of the skills have combo finishers. Oh my God, there's landmines everywhere. I don't know who's there.
I like that some of the people you're around have really legitimate, like, I'm role-playing names, and then you're also fighting alongside Tobias Funke.
How do you know that's not a role-playing name?
And Devil Knight.
Yep.
Okay.
But some of the attacks have, like, combo fin... Oh, my God. I just lost all of my health in about 3 seconds.
Yeah, I think you kind of got chosen as to be the chosen target there by, like, 5 people.
Hammer toss.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I'm totally dead. But the combo finisher effects... That's how the classes work together. So if an elementalist or something, who's basically the caster type, the dedicated caster type, were to set up like a fire field, and I got in the middle of it and did Whirling Axe, which is this, and I can actually move around while I'm using this. He's just flipping out. I don't know how he sustains that.
It's like a Tasmanian devil attack.
Yeah. So if there's a fire field and I do that in it, it'll probably, I mean, I haven't seen the effect yet, but it'll probably shoot fire all over the place. So you get kind of a bonus effect of using, oh, there's Sickgirl again. You get a bonus effect if you're using the right skill at the right time. Man. So there's that whole aspect of the game that, I mean, I've only played in limited beta sessions, so I haven't gotten a great feel for how that all works together so far, but it seems pretty cool.
Engineers are so cool, too, that guy that you see rolling around with the flamethrower. I just think it's really cool how this game is like a fantasy game, but it totally combines it with like weird steampunk elements, how he's throwing down turrets, using a flamethrower.
Yeah, engineers seem really dangerous, and the flamethrower that you can equip on them do tons of damage. I was using that in one of the dungeon runs, and yeah, whenever I was in trouble, I would just immediately
equip the flamethrower,
and then everything would be fine. Stomp. I think that worked. Sickgirl is almost dead. I have a slowing attack, and she's down.
I'm gonna say that that was all you.
There we go.
Yeah,
you do need to do that extra fatality on the ground so that they can't revive themselves. But yeah, Anthony, I mean, I would really like to know when this game is actually coming out.
Yeah, according to GameStop, it was like this week or next week or something, but that's not happening.
That wasn't accurate. So this could be a combo field here.
I kind of feel like at this point, you know, it's a wait and see between Blizzard and these guys.
Yeah, like, I feel like they're sort of playing like a game of chicken in terms of, are you going to announce the release date for Mists of Pandaria? Because we're just going to kind of sit back until you do that.
And avoid that date. And I feel like Blizzard's like, we want to release on the same day as you.
Yeah.
That's a total Blizzard thing to do.
I mean, Blizzard could do that. I know WoW has been losing subscribers, although the most recent report had them stable at, I believe it was 10.2 million.
Yeah, I mean, obviously amazing stuff.
That's still an absolutely crazy number of people subscribed to a game and playing it actively. That's nuts. And that's certainly better than Star Wars The Old Republic has been faring, considering it lost 400K in its first...
couple months.
Yeah, in the earnings call this year, they were like, it went down to 1.3 from 1.7 million. 1.3 million, still an insane number of people playing the game, but
yes.
if that rate were to continue, that is bad. That is very concerning. And there were actually layoffs at BioWare Austin shortly after that announcement that became public.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I have a paid subscription to WoW. I do not have a paid subscription to Tor.
I'm still subscribed to Tor. I have a 50 on there. I play as a sorcerer that is focused on healing, so I'm basically a healer in that game. And it's okay. It's just I sort of, once the main questing content was all done, I just, combo field.
Yeah, I mean, I could totally see myself starting it up again if there was an expansion that continued my bounty hunter story.
And they're supposed to be this year. So. That is supposed to be happening. They said they're adding a new planet, Makeb, that's supposed to have all new questing content. Damn it. I totally should have killed that person. But, I mean, I am definitely more excited about Guild Wars 2 at this point than I am about additional Tor content.
That character you're fighting, is it an NPC? I think it is, with that name.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think that's a player. I don't think there are any... I'm not sure... Actually, you know what? I think there are NPCs on some of these... arena maps, but they're kind of out of the way. This is not an NPC.
Okay, it was just she had two names, so I wasn't sure.
And then there's also the Secret World, which comes out really, really soon.
Yeah, like I'm pretty sure that you can start playing the actual game this, like...
It's the 29th.
Yeah,
the 29th is when Early Access starts, and then it launches on the 3rd of July. And that game just has no buzz whatsoever.
Just in time to not play it on the vacation.
Yeah, and it's just, I don't know. I mean, I liked Age of Conan. It had, plenty of issues at launch, but I thought it was still fun. They at least tried to do something slightly different
yes.
with the combat system.
No, but, I mean...
The Secret World definitely does some things that are interesting. Like, when I've seen it for preview... you know, their whole skill system, you basically just pick your own way through the skill tree. You don't choose a preset class at the start, which is kind of a cool mechanic. And the setting is certainly original. You don't see a lot of that at all in MMOs.
Yeah, it's like a really good take on a different way of handling fantasy, but not being like high fantasy. I think that could help it. From what I played story-wise, I thought they'd do a really cool job with some of the storytelling. And
yeah, there are actual cutscenes in the game. I don't know how frequent they are, but the cutscenes are the type where it's not just like the Old Republic, where it's basically cutting back and forth between two camera angles, and it's always the same framing on the characters. They're more cinematic cutscenes. It looks almost film-like, where there are different camera angles all over the place and things like that. So it does seem, if those are pretty frequent, that seems like a cool way... to tell a tale, and the content is certainly mature from what they've shown on press tours. They've shown off some very sexually explicit material, some very violent material, so they're aiming for an older crowd for that game, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, no one wants to see a game fail. Like, it would be really cool to see that game succeed, but
just because there hasn't been a lot of buzz in the media doesn't necessarily mean that nobody's interested, but it is rare that you see so little hype around it's pretty much a major MMO launch. I mean, it's Funcom, it's, you know, EA's involved. It's a big launch, and it's just nobody really seems all that excited about it.
So, I mean, some of these PvP matches you're doing in Guild Wars, they also involve straight, like, deathmatch, right? Where it's just, like, kill the other team. Do they all generally have, like, a kind of...
We can do that, but on the maps that I've played so far, they're... Oh, my God, he's got birds on his head.
I don't know what was up with that.
That's the dreaded bird attack. That's... I don't know if that guy's going to come out of there. No, he was definitely going to attack by birds. The maps that I've played all have kind of special mechanics associated with them, with capture and hold style mechanics, which is what we're doing right now. We're capturing this point. You can see the progress bar up here. So it isn't just the straight-up deathmatching. But there is the whole open-world element, which is really cool, and it's something that something like the Old Republic sort of tried to do and horribly failed with Ilum. But it is a way for players to just jump in and take part in a open-world PvP fight where there are a whole bunch of capturable... like keeps and castles and smaller towns and villages and things like that, and PvE challenges on the huge maps, and then depending on how your and it's actually for your server, depending on how your server does in its battle against two other factions, the bonuses that you accrue there count back towards everyone in the PvE game, so you get bonuses back depending on how everyone's performing there, which is kind of cool because it's just that's that extra incentive to be like, okay, well, you know, we need to be doing this well, and then everyone benefits.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, I think, avoid PvP because they don't always see a point to it if it's just additional gear or something like that, but if it employs a group-wide benefit, I could see more people at least wanting to participate in it.
Yeah, more people would want to get involved. Even if it's a new player, oh my god, what just happened?
Oh no.
A giant space orb floated over my head. Alright, I'm gonna have to stomp and get out of here.
I think this is a rogue. Oh yeah, her team's...
Actually, you know what? I'm gonna see if...
I love how it's not just a...
I'm gonna see how my Super Saiyan move works here.
I love how it's not just a stomp either. It's not like, well, I mean, it's a stomp, but it doesn't just pop up like a I'm a dazed thing above her head. She actually goes flying. Like, there's a certain physicality to the fighting in Guild Wars that I think works really well.
Yeah, it's got a good feel to it, too. Like, you get used to the rhythm of the skills and how they all work together, and there's another stomp. Unfortunately, I don't think that one hit.
She evaded, yeah.
But yeah, it's just really quick. It feels very responsive. This is definitely the MMO I'm looking forward to most right now. I mean, WoW, Mists of Pandaria could be cool. I haven't played much of the beta yet. And their Pokemon pet battle system sounds like they're definitely experimenting with different ideas. I've played so much World of Warcraft at this point.
Yeah, and I mean, they're even making the skill system even way more simple with Mists of Pandaria. And like in my opinion, this game, if you want like
how
to do
reworked
elaborate,
the talent trees you're talking about?
Yeah, and but in this game, if you want like elaborate, really like customizable skill systems, this game is not a bad option. The skill systems are pretty intense. Like they're very manageable, but there's a lot of options to it.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot to learn in this game. Not only does every weapon have a different skill set, but if I go over to my slot skills here, you can see I have these heals I can pick from. I have all of these skills that I can slot into these three areas, and then a little bit of elite skills. But then there's the whole trait system in here, which I haven't even played around with very much, because that's more to do with leveling and things like that, where you unlock here. These are all very specific bonuses, ways to customize your character.
Yeah, it almost reminds me of like the rune system in like something like League of Legends, like where it's like little ways to do very specific specializations.
Yeah, like look at this, like extra armor when health is above 90%. Okay.
You want to be a tank though, that's great. Probably a good idea.
So yeah, you just got a lot of options there. And then there's the full crafting system and stuff like that. It'll be really cool to see how that all ties in. And what one thing I think is really cool about this game is their achievement system that they have built in actually gives you experience bonuses as you're leveling.
And their daily achievements, that's nice.
Daily, monthly, all these different achievements that you can earn. So you can actually speed up your leveling if you're playing through the base game, through the base PvE questing content. By getting achievements. So they do pop up, you get that nice feeling of reward when it's like, hey, I completed something random, and then it's like, by the way, here's a reward that's actually useful. That's a nice twist on it. So I don't know how much more beta testing is going to happen with this game. It feels like it's been quite a bit so far.
And it feels like at this point, like if this was launched, I would be like, okay, this feels like a
launch
product.
It's in good shape, yeah. For sure. It's definitely in good shape. It's not like... I remember playing in the Age of Conan beta, and before launching, it was like, I don't know.
A little rough, yeah.
I don't know about the performance on this one, but Guild Wars feels very smooth, very stable, and I mean, yes, there are issues here and there.
Oh,
but,
God, it's the rogue again.
It seems pretty good. It feels like it could be close to launch, and they've done a lot of polish on their UI again. But yeah, I mean, we'll be continuing to cover Guild Wars 2 as it moves towards actual launch, whenever that winds up happening. This is not going very well for me. Maybe I should switch over to axes.
I just think that maybe a rogue is a tough fight for you, or whatever they call their rogues.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not super familiar with this skill set yet. All right, I'm just gonna go crazy whirlwind. Oh, I actually have two people attacking me right now. Run away!
And that was the end of Charles.
And that was it. But yeah, I mean, we'll be continuing to cover this on IGN as we get into more beta sessions and stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, certainly my most anticipated MMO of the year. And we'll see how successful it is once it launches, considering it doesn't actually have a subscription fee. But it's also not free to play.
Nope. Gotta buy it once, at least.
You do have to make that one full-priced purchase, and then you can play the game. But yeah, it's not entirely free to play, which I know makes some people nervous, perhaps.
I would rather pay one cost up front than monthly subscription.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Instead of one cost up front with something like WoW or Tor, and then a giant subscription on top of that. That's such a difficult thing to do. I had to unsubscribe from Terra because I was just like, I can't do this anymore. Terra was, I was actually excited for Terra, and it was just so boring. It was just, like, I played 10 levels and was like, oh man, this combat feels totally different, awesome. And then I played, like, 12 levels and was like, wow, this is, like, the most boring thing ever.
Yeah.
It's just so, the questing and everything is just so standard.
I mean, who has time in their life for more than one MMO anyway?
And yeah, it's very difficult to double those up anyway. Also, Diablo came out. So
just
that happened.
Just that game.
Yeah. Hey, so now we're checking out Dota 2. This is a MOBA, I guess, or action RTS, or just a Dota game.
Yeah, MOBA or Dota game at this point is probably the most synonymous with the genre.
You know, it's funny. I labeled a video on YouTube action RTS for Dota recently because we've been doing Dota profiles for all the heroes in this game since there are so many. And everyone was flipping out, but that's actually what Valve called the game. If you go to the Steam page and look at Valve's description of Dota, they call it an action RTS, so that was not just made up randomness. You know,
God forbid you try and be proper about it.
So I got so people got angry at me for that, but yeah, I was pulling that off of Valve's page because I the term MOBA just sounds so dumb.
It does. I know it's totally just made up because they didn't want to because the people at like League of Legends didn't want to keep calling it
Dota
game.
Yeah, even though Dota also makes sense because that's basically what started it.
Right.
Anyway, so this is in closed beta testing. There's no release date yet. I know a lot of people want to hear from Valve what they're doing with Half-Life and things like that, but it's Dota and Counter-Strike now, and Counter-Strike is coming out actually in a few months, and it wouldn't be surprising if Dota 2 actually was released, officially launched sometime soon, because, I mean, it's really polished.
I play it, like, every night lately, and
wow, that is horrible language. Sorry about that.
I play it like every night, and
do that.
And it's totally like a ridiculously polished game at this point. Like I already feel like maybe it has balance issues or something, but
I mean they do balance tweaks in updates. I mean they update the beta very regularly. They add in new heroes, there are microtransactions you can make, like the giant flower he's carrying around. I've actually done a few microtransactions in-game. I've purchased keys for treasure chests, because after matches, you will sometimes get random rewards, like when your profile levels up, or just randomly. And yeah, I've gotten treasure chests, and then you can buy a key for basically, I think it's like 250, that opens the treasure chest, and you just get random stuff. I actually really like the model that they have implemented into Dota 2 for payments, because all of the heroes are actually free, so it's not like you need to pay for individual heroes or things like that.
That's one big advantage I feel like this game's going to have over a lot of its competition, like League of Legends and stuff, is that in League you're pretty much, if you're a customer who wants to play for free, you know, you're limited to whatever characters are free that week, and earning currency to eventually get them. But that takes a long time, and in this it's like everyone's there right off the bat. And I feel like that then gives everyone time to experiment with characters, find out the ones that they really love, and then want to buy cheap skinned items for them.
Right, and if you did want the giant flower staff for Nature's Prophet back there, there are no statistical benefits to that.
No. It's purely aesthetic.
You're not like, oh man, the flower guy, oh, I'm screwed now, I can't go near him. It's like, that's strictly for appearance. Oh man, oh, faceless man. Boy, now he took cover behind the tower.
I mean,
Razor's, I love that attack so much. It's right here, it's called Plasma Field. That actually does damage on the way out and back. So you can potentially tag someone twice. And actually, the further you are away from a target when that hits, the more damage it will do. Which is a pretty neat way to kind of micro that skill.
One of the things that we kind of talked about earlier in the show was, like, you know, the idea of games that could only exist on PC, and it's like, I still feel like, I don't know, I know that there's that Lord of the Rings sort of Dota-style game coming out, but I still feel like this is a genre that really is, like, this is a PC genre. Like, I feel like, you know, there have been MMOs that existed on console, and I feel like it's possible to do that, but I still feel like this game really is a PC game.
Yeah, they're, if you've ever played a Dota-style game, a MOBA, an action RTS, whatever you want to call it, there's a lot of clicking involved. It's very much about precision, even though to somebody uninitiated it may look, you know, Diablo-like in that sense, where you're running around from this overhead perspective. You've got your skill bar down here, you know, your equipped items that modify your behavior. But it is very skill based.
Yeah, I mean, when I play with someone who is just vastly better than me, I can tell. Like, it's like I literally have no chance just because they are far and away much better than I am. It's amazing how much skill goes into this when you only have like four abilities. Many of the characters don't even have active abilities for each of them. Some are passive. You know,
yeah, it's true. Some like Chaos Knight here. He at least has one.
Yeah, he has a passive.
He has a passive that increases critical hit strike, which I can. I'm in the observing mode right now, so I'm not actually playing. So I can go over to Hero Chase and check out Chaos Knight. I actually like Chaos Knight a lot. His two actives right here, like Chaos Bolt, will deal damage and stun. But it's a little weird because it looks like they're taking out Roshan down there. But the damage and the stun duration aren't always consistent, so you will stun between 2 to 4 seconds. And if you get a 4 second stun, that's a pretty big stun.
That can be like game changing.
That's pretty much if you're with your team, that's pretty much a kill at that point. And then Reality Rift will actually tell it. Let's see if he uses it. If they're going to get into a fight here. Oh no, Faceless Void is doing his thing. Yeah.
If you couldn't tell, a player at one point existed in there.
They seem to be in a pretty well-organized pack here, but Reality Rift actually teleports Chaos Knight and his target to someplace in the middle between them in a line, except the location isn't always known. That's kind of the random element there, so you could be closer to your original position or closer to the enemy's position, but it usually will pull them back, so you can maybe pull them back from behind a tower or something like that. It's really useful for ganking.
Oh man, we're about to see if he battle go down. That axe really wants
to. Oh, so he just used Phantasm and Reality Rift there, so what that does, Phantasm, these phantom horses you see running around here, those are copies of the Chaos Knight. Those will do full damage. So getting hit by one of those is like getting hit by Chaos Knight, but they die faster.
Yeah.
So they won't stick around as long. But if you teleport them through Reality Rift, which he did, then you're basically right next to your opponent and you get the next attack they land, they will all attack simultaneously. So you'll basically get, in that case, 3 attacks instead of 1.
That was a great example of
or actually he does have his ultimate maxed out here, so that'll be 3 copies.
That was a great example though of really skilled play. Like right there, everyone used their powers in conjunction. They wiped out the whole team.
Yeah, you'll see everyone's waiting for respawn timers up here. And yeah, if you do die in this game, the objective is there are the 2 bases. There's one down here in this corner, one up here, and you want to blow up all of the towers along these lanes on the map and eventually just run into your enemy's base and blow it up. Pretty simple objective. It's just the way of doing that is pretty complicated. I'll get off Chaos Knight here since he's not really doing anything.
The cool thing too about Dota right now is that you can totally like buy your way into the game if you want. Like it is free to play, but you can pay like $39 I think and get access to it right now and get a bunch of items as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, it's true. That's kind of, it's like, oh, it's free to play. Also, you can buy it for $40. It's
right
like,
now, yeah.
All right. Yeah, that's the beta up or access price.
It includes some skins and stuff. I mean, they try and make it worth your while in paid for items as well, but I don't know. This is just one of those games that I really hated at first because this one's trying very much so to be like, I play a lot of League of Legends, but this one was very much so trying to be true to the old Dota format, which I never really got into, but I hated the idea of denial, which is where you're killing your own guys. Because if you get the last hit on them, you deny the enemy team experience and gold. Or at least gold. I don't know about experience as well, but
yeah, you can't get that last hit gold bonus, basically.
Right, and so that can really make a difference over the long run if you keep them from getting a bunch of gold. And they don't have that in League of Legends, and I know that that's like been a contentious point for a lot of this community. And for me, it was like, I'm just not good enough at last hitting. I always felt like I'd be a detriment to my team.
Last hitting is tough. It's a lot of micromanagement, especially in the early laning phase, to be able to keep up with... Wow, everyone just got completely annihilated right there. But yeah, to be able to keep up with not only last hitting, but yeah, also making sure that your opponent does not get last hits by landing denials.
Yeah, I mean, I just didn't think I was that good at it. Actually, I still know I'm not that good at it, but at this point, no one really is, I feel like.
Well, yeah, and I mean, you know, if you're just doing public matchmaking, if you're not in this for the hyper-competitive professional style, I've seen, then I found that a lot of people just in the pickup games, you know, they'll have three denials or something like that. They'll maybe four, but nobody goes like way hardcore into it to the point where they're just denying everything, which can make a significant difference if you're a carry, if you're somebody who needs to make
a ton
money
of money
to get the powerful items so that you can really dominate a battle or something like that.
Yeah, so at this point, I feel like that a lot of my fears of that were kind of, I mean, at this point, you know, let's face it, I'm never going to be a competitive Dota player.
I've accepted that as well.
Yeah, so, you know, as long as I accept that, I should be fine. Oh, man, this guy doesn't even know he's being stalked. This is about to be bad for this team. The losing team is trying to do a little bit of something, but...
Chaos Knight's not in very good shape there. There, he just went Phantasm. Let's see if he uses Reality Rift. I don't know if he's going to get there. There it is! And he's almost dead. And he also has... So Chaos Knight has a passive so that he'll actually get increased critical hit damage right down here, as well as critical hit chance. The most recent addition into the game, who I haven't actually played yet, is Rubick.
He's pretty tough. I mean, I was fighting him last night. That guy can definitely nuke someone pretty hard.
Here we go. So his really interesting ability is Spell Steal. That's his ultimate. And he can just take other people's spells. Like, here you go. He's got Scream of Pain. That's not normally his spell. So
no, that's
he just takes other people's stuff when he's running around the battlefield, which can be extremely useful as he's kind of switching that around. He's very dangerous. I do not like playing against him whatsoever.
If he gets the right spell combination, he can run up to you and you can be the most hardcore DPS character and he can just blow you up if it's a one-on-one.
Yeah, he does have a weird thing going on with his robe, though, where it just will not stop jittering. I don't know. Maybe he put a little too much starch in the wash or something like that.
I guess that's the thing, right? We say that it's early, and that's true. Tidehunter, the character I like to play, too. I actually like to walk in circles because his fish will get caught on geometry and then freak out.
Yeah, I don't know if that, maybe there'll be an anti-jitter patch for Rubick at some point later. I don't know, but yeah, that's what he's got going on right now. But yeah, games of Dota 2 typically take around, I guess, 40 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, both teams here know the game's over.
It's so disappointing, though, when it's like 20 minutes in, and so you're at that point where you're pretty much committed to the game, but the way it's been going, you know that it's just not gonna work out.
At this point, yeah, the other side hasn't lost any of their towers. They've lost all of their outer towers. They've lost most of their inner towers. Like, they're basically just fending them off temporarily while the other team recoups, comes back, and destroys them again.
Axe feels dumb.
They could, at this point, finish it. I guess they're just being kind of lazy.
Maybe. I haven't actually checked the level layout, but yeah, one team definitely has a leveling advantage, and I'm sure if I check their items, they would have much stronger items as well. And you can actually see a whole bunch of cool different statistics up here. If you are into watching games, here's the gold distribution, here's the XP distribution. You can see that swinging way in favor of one side from pretty much the beginning of the game. It's just been going in that direction, and actually it seems like accelerating quite a bit as the game has gone on. But yeah, you have a lot of cool observation tools up here in case you're super hardcore into observing and things like that.
I mean, that's the fun thing, right? Is that even if you have no intention of playing Dota, it's almost worth it to download sometimes just to watch games. It's so fun to watch games. Like, I just put it on the background all the time.
Yeah, I mean, so you could play, if you were trying to test out a hero that you've never played yet, you could go into a practice mode and fight against bots and things like that, where you know, it doesn't actually give you battle points to level up your profile if you do that, but you get a good sense of how the character actually works. Or you could just try to find a game where somebody's actually using someone like Razor or something like that, so you could watch somebody play around with them and get a sense of how they work. And then all of your games are tracked in your profile, and you can go back and access them and watch the replays with all of these cool tools in there, so that you can really get a sense of what went on in the match, in case it was one of those matches where you're just like, all right, seriously,
what happened?
What just happened? Like, we just got, you know, sledgehammered or something like that. Then you can actually go back and watch exactly what the other team was doing, which is really nice. It's just a lot of ways to help you get better.
Yeah. Well, I think we've seen enough of this. This is now heading into watching someone be tortured.
Yeah, they're into the base now. It's going to be game over pretty soon. But yeah, that's a look at Dota 2. We'll be continuing to cover this on IGN just because, you know, it's going to be a very big deal. It's very popular on Steam right now. Obviously, Dota has been very popular for years now, so it'll be really interesting to see how that's affected by the launch version of something that has Valve's name on it this time.
Yeah, I thank you guys for everyone for sitting with us for our first episode of Command Prompt.
Yeah, and hopefully we will have this up on a weekly basis, just showing off three games that are pretty cool in the PC scene, whether they're new games, whether they're in development, or whether they're really old. Maybe we'll just go back and play Doom 2 or something like that. Who knows? But yeah, thanks for watching and listening, and we'll see you next time.